So I just recently released a video about igneous and metamorphic gemstones, and in this video, I'm going to be going over how sedimentary and hydrothermal gemstones are formed. So first off, really quick, I'm going to recap, just in case you didn't watch the first part, what gemstones are. They are minerals, rocks, or organic materials that possess exceptional beauty, rarity, and durability that make them valuable. They're often used in jewelry, decor, and sometimes industrial purposes, and they exhibit a range of colors, transparencies, lusters, and optical properties. Gemstones form through many types of geological processes, like igneous ones, metamorphic ones involving high temperature and high pressure, but can also be formed in sedimentary environments, which are many of the ones we'll talk about in today's video. Therefore, they can basically be found kind of anywhere on Earth, any environment, because they're not just formed by one process. There actually is such a variety, they can be formed in many different ways. In terms of sedimentary types of rock formation or mineral and rock formation, we have clastic sedimentary deposits that basically form when sediment is transported and deposited on Earth's surface in rivers or ocean basins, like this process shown here. Loose sediment is transported to this basin and deposited on the sea floor or lake floor, whatever it is, and then it gets compacted and buried over time. Chemical sedimentary deposition, however, is different because it's when minerals precipitate directly from solution. Basically, you have water rich in certain ions. For example, if it's rich in sodium and chloride ions, then it evaporates, then it leaves behind that sodium chloride as halite, which is salt, a chemical sedimentary mineral. And the last type of sedimentary deposit is biogenic sedimentary deposition, basically minerals secreted by organisms. So shells and skeletons of organisms are formed by biogenic, the biological production of minerals like calcium carbonate, calcium phosphate, things like that. So these are the three types of sedimentary deposition, but like I mentioned in the title of the video, it is how sedimentary and hydrothermal gemstones form. So let me just take a second to describe the distinction here. Metamorphism is a process in which pre-existing rocks are put under high temperature and high pressure. Hydrothermal alteration, which is the alteration of rocks by hot mineral-rich fluids, is a type of low pressure, low grade metamorphism. So, this metamorphism versus hydrothermal gemstone formation distinction is fuzzy and it's not technically like official. It's just the way that I split things up. What I consider more sedimentary type of hydrothermal deposits, I included in this video, whereas the more metamorphic ones I included in the last video. What I mean by that is that sometimes hydrothermal alteration can cause the transformation of pre-existing rocks and minerals to reprecipitate new minerals or replace them with new minerals. And these are the types of gemstones I included in the last video. Whereas the more sedimentary or chemical sedimentary types I included in this video, in other words, those that form from direct precipitation from hydrothermal solutions. The examples that I will be talking about in this video include opal, citrine, amethyst, moonstone, onyx, pearl, coral, and amber. And the ones I talked about in the previous video, if you don't see your favorite gemstone listed here, are diamond, ruby, sapphire, tourmaline, emerald, aquamarine, garnet, peridot, jade, topaz, lapis lazuli, and turquoise. So if you want to see any of those minerals being described or how they form, you can check out the previous video. Note that this is not a complete list. Neither of these lists are complete. I did not have time in these two videos to discuss all gemstones ever. There is an exhaustive list of gemstones. So if you don't see your favorite listed here, please feel free to comment down below which one you'd like me to cover in a future video, and I will hopefully be able to make more videos on gemstones in the future. First example we'll talk about in this video is opal. I had such a fun time picking the pictures for opal. Opals are unique gemstones that are known for their play of colors. Opals shimmer, it's kind of a rainbow shimmer as you move it around, is known as a play of color. There are a few minerals that exhibit play of color, and some of them I'll talk about in this video, others I've talked about in other videos. I'll link the video where I introduced the term play of color up to the top right if you want to check it out. Opals form where there's been recent volcanic activity or in sedimentary environments rich in silica. Basically, silica-rich water infiltrate through porous rocks or sediments and precipitates or directly deposits from solution silica or silicon dioxide between grains. Slow evaporation of the water and solidification of the silica can occur over thousands of years, very slowly, forming a 3D array of silica spheres. So this slow crystallization process of the silica is key for opal formation because it needs to form this 3D array of silica spheres in order to reflect light in the way that it does to form this play of color. Basically, they scatter the light in like all the directions because they're spheres, and this causes the beautiful shimmer of opals. Now, silica, I do need to specify because silica is the composition of many common minerals like opal, amethyst, citrine, which we'll go over in a second, obsidian, chert, flint, chalcedony varieties. There's so many minerals and gemstones with the same composition, that is silicon dioxide. The reason that it forms so many different minerals and different gemstones, yet it's the same composition, is just because in each different type, it's a different structure. So the 3D array of silica spheres is only present in opal, whereas in quartz, it's a different structure. In obsidian, it's a different structure. In chert, it's microcrystalline. In chalcedony, it's a different kind of microcrystalline quartz. It's a whole, like, there's all these different structures and sizes of crystal lattices for silicon dioxide, and that's why it forms so many different varieties. The tiny, regularly packed silica spheres diffract light, creating opalescence, like I just mentioned. Opalescence is the term for the shine that opal gives off. And the size and arrangement of the spheres determines the quality of the opal, or the shimmeriness of the opal. Moving on to the next silica type of gemstone, that is amethyst and citrine. These are both varieties of quartz, basically, which is silicon dioxide. Again, it's one of the most abundant minerals on Earth, and it forms under a variety of conditions. Very common. However, quartz is typically clear or milky or smoky in color, while amethyst and citrine are purple and orange, respectively, due to iron impurities. They often form in hydrothermal veins where fractures in rocks are filled with hot iron and silica-rich fluids that precipitate amethyst and citrine. And we can actually make amethyst and citrine from quartz with iron impurities. Long-term exposure to heat and radiation alters the oxidation state of iron impurities in quartz, leading to the purple color of amethyst. So, in other words, iron impurities being present doesn't necessarily guarantee that you'll get amethyst or citrine. It might not be in the right oxidation state. In other words, the iron in the structure might not have the right amount of electrons to cause the purple or orange color of amethyst or citrine. But if you heat or irradiate iron-containing quartz to the point that that changes, you can cause the purple color of amethyst. If you then subject the iron-containing quartz or amethyst to even higher temperatures, this can further alter the iron oxidation state, leading to citrine. However, I wouldn't recommend trying this at home. If you have amethyst, I wouldn't necessarily say that you can make it citrine by throwing it in the oven, because you likely won't reach the temperature required for citrine unless your oven goes up to 400 to 500 degrees Celsius or 752 to 932 degrees Fahrenheit. Please don't burn your house down. Next, we'll talk about moonstone. Moonstone is another favorite of mine, very similar to opal, not in composition, but it has a very similar sheen and it's very beautiful. Moonstone is actually a feldspar mineral. Finally, we're getting away from the silica composition, and this potassium feldspar mineral is called orthoclase. Basically, K-spar, which is what orthoclase is sometimes nicknamed, is composed of aluminum silicate and potassium. Orthoclase feldspar, or K-spar, is common in granites and pegmatites. And if you ever see granites and or pegmatites that are pinkish in color, just like this pegmatite crystal here, it's typically due to the potassium within the feldspar that it is this pinkish, peach-ish color. And pegmatites, if you don't know, they're just really large crystals that form due to slow cooling magma. I talk about pegmatites in my previous gemstone video if you want to check that out. Basically, magma intrudes in pegmatites or granitic rocks, and when the feldspar in the magma crystallizes slowly, larger and more well-defined crystals form. And the shimmer of moonstones, which is called agilorescence or sheen, is due to light interference. Basically, the feldspar structure of moonstone specifically includes these thin alternating layers of albite and orthoclase, two different varieties of feldspar, within their crystal grain. So the light enters these thin alternating layers, and then it's scattered and reflected, creating the agilorescence. If the albite and orthoclase were not structured like this, then it would just be plain old dull feldspar. It would no longer be moonstone. And keep in mind that if you are ever hunting for moonstone, you typically need to polish the feldspar down in order to see the agilorescent glow. The surfaces can sometimes be weathered in some way, or just kind of etched in some way that interferes with the light interaction to the point that it looks dull. And it isn't until you polish them down that you can actually see the agilorescence. Next, we'll talk about onyx, which is a variety of chalcedony. Chalcedony, again, is silica in composition, silicon dioxide, and it's just a type of microcrystalline quartz. Chert or flint, that's also a mineral that is a type of microcrystalline quartz, but chalcedony is typically more, it's like a difference between like matte lipstick and shiny lipstick. The chert is matte, chalcedony is shiny, at least in my experience with these minerals. And onyx and other types of chalcedony can form by silica precipitation from hydrothermal solutions and fractures and voids in rocks. Very similar to what we talked about earlier with regards to opal formation. Just instead of the silica precipitating over a long enough time to form these perfectly packed spheres, it instead forms microcrystalline quartz, which, when you have microcrystalline things or things with smaller crystal grain sizes, is typically due to faster crystallization or faster cooling. So, this is a faster formation process than something like opal, even though it's the same composition. Deposition of silica in these cracks starts at the edges and gradually builds up to form layers of chalcedony to form bands with different colors. In the case of onyx, it typically contains white and black bands. Now, I do want to mention that variations in solution composition, temperature, or the flow of the fluids and the rate of flow can influence the formation and the color of the bands. And this banded type of silica formation is actually just how all agates form. So, agates are also varieties of chalcedony, and in fact, onyx, when banded like this, could technically be classified as an agate. We've classified them based on geological processes and based on jewelry and like prettiness, and these don't always match up. Geologically, agates and onyx and basically all chalcedony types are the same. They just have different color bands depending on the different impurities within the silica that precipitates from the solution in each band. Chalcedony and onyx and all the other types of chalcedony can typically withstand greater degrees of weathering and erosion than its host rock. Thus, we can typically find onyx and other types of chalcedony and agates on their own rather than within their cavities and veins. So this makes it, fun to go like agate hunting or onyx hunting or whatever, because sometimes if you're looking in alluvial deposits where things have been weathered and transported, you can see the onyx or the agate is by itself because the host rock that it was in weathered and eroded away. Next, we have the more actual sedimentary types of gemstones. The ones we've talked about thus far have been mainly hydrothermal in formation, and this is a type of metamorphism. And now we're getting to real sedimentary types of gemstones that form at Earth's surface and in low temperature environments. Pearls are an example of these, and pearls form inside the shells of some bivalves, some mollusks, such as oysters and mussels. And they form as a defense mechanism against irritants. An irritant, such as a sand grain or a shell fragment or a parasite or basically anything that gets inside the shell that shouldn't be inside the cell, basically gets into the soft tissues of the mollusk, either naturally or by human intervention, mind you. And this causes the mollusk's epithelial cells or skin cells to cover the irritant with layers of nacre, also known as mother of pearl. Nacre is composed of aragonite, calcium carbonate mineral, which is the same thing as most shells are formed of, and it also contains layers of organic material. The mollusk secretes concentric layers of nacre over the irritant, resulting in the formation of the pearl. Pearl growth can take several months to years, depending on the mollusk type and environmental conditions. The size, shape, and luster are also influenced by these factors. The structure of the pearl is this kind of overlapping layers of aragonite, the hexagonal calcium carbonate crystals here, and organic platelets of conchiolin, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, that diffract and reflect light to produce the shimmer of pearls. Next, we have coral. Before I talk about how coral forms, let me just talk a little bit about why it's considered a gemstone. From what I read, coral is considered an organic gemstone, as opposed to most of the ones we've talked about, which are inorganic. And I should also mention that it's funny that corals are considered organic, because the part of coral, its skeleton, that we use as the gemstone is actually inorganic in terms of its mineralogy, but it's fine. It's considered an organic gemstone because, again, what we describe as geologists isn't always what jewelry people describe or classify things as. Anyway, it's an organic gemstone, and it's considered a gemstone due to its beauty, rarity, and use in jewelry. While coral reefs are found in various parts of the world, the coral that we consider gem quality is limited. Precious corals, for example, red and pink varieties, are rare, and coral harvesting is and has become more tightly regulated over time to protect ecosystems. Therefore, gem coral is kind of going up in value, and therefore it's considered a gemstone. So, how does it form? Well, corals secrete calcium carbonate as their skeletons. Just like we talked about with the mollusks creating pearls, they secrete calcium carbonate or aragonite with organic matter to cover the irritant within them to form the pearls. Well, corals secrete calcium carbonate as their skeletons or hard structures that can support them, and these can build up to form large reef ecosystems. Many corals have symbiotic relationships with algae called zooxanthellae. And basically, corals provide protection, and the algae provides nutrients for the corals. These nutrients give the corals enough energy to continue to draw in calcium ions and carbonate ions from seawater to form more calcium carbonate for their skeletons. Coral growth rates, or coral calcium carbonate growth rates, depend on water temperature, light, nutrient availability, and the species of coral. Last, we have amber. Amber is fossilized tree resin, and trees produce resin or sap as a defense mechanism against injury or disease. Tree resin can trap small pieces of plant matter or small organisms like insects, and often can lead to fossilized insects that are much better preserved than any fossilized insect would be in a regular old rock. Over time, resin undergoes polymerization, a process in which it gradually solidifies due to the loss of volatiles and exposure to air over thousands to millions of years. And its composition is not inorganic, it's actually organic. So it's carbon, hydrogen. I don't know the exact composition of amber. I'm sure it varies depending on species. I could be wrong about that. Comment below if you know. But it is not a typical inorganic mineral composition. So that's why I didn't list it here. So those are all the sedimentary and hydrothermal gemstones that, well, not all of them, but all the ones that I felt were common enough to talk about in this video, common slash or cool enough to talk about. And like I said earlier, there's a fuzzy distinction between hydrothermal and metamorphic. Again, this is not an official distinction, just one that I made to make the videos somewhat equal length. I don't think I did very well at that because I think the previous one was much longer. In any case, my references are always linked down in my description box below, and I can't wait to see you guys in the next video. Bye!